Penguin Random House Audio presents Blood Farm, the explosive Big Pharma scandal that altered the AIDS crisis. Written and read by me, Cara McGoogan. Things fall apart. The centre cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. W.B. Yeats, The Second Coming. Prologue. The Farm. At the northern edge of Louisiana, the state line cuts a sharp turn south and follows the shape of the Mississippi River, meandering left and right with the flow of the water. 250 kilometres pass from Lake Providence to Lettsworth before the border heads eastwards at a right angle, drawing the state into a fat L shape. In the corner of that L is a penned-in plot of land. On one side, the slow-moving hulk of the river. On the other, barbed wire fences. It's here that Isaac Franklin, co-founder of the largest slave trading company in the United States, created 7 plantations in the 1830s. Franklin brought in enslaved people to work the fields overlooking the river, harvesting sugarcane, cotton, and corn. From the break of day until nightfall, they toiled under the blistering southern sun. The subtropical climate in this region can be erratic. Periods of biting heat and overpowering mugginess are swept away by frenzied storms. Winter is a respite. With slavery, Franklin imported a new name to the area, Angola, after the country where he had stolen his lucrative trade. Following the abolition of slavery in 1865, Angola adapted, but failed to outgrow its roots. What was once a plantation became land farmed by leased convicts. Prisoners, many of them descendants of enslaved people, had to work for little or no recompense. By 1901, this arrangement was formalised, and Angola took on its contemporary form. Barbed wire fences were erected along with a sprawling complex of imposing buildings. Angola was now Louisiana State Penitentiary. All the while, it retained its singular history of exploitation and brutality. Angola became the largest maximum security prison in America, with more than 5,000 inmates and nearly 2,000 members of staff. Those serving time have committed the most violent crimes, including murder, rape, and armed robbery. Many have a life sentence with hard labour. And so it came to be that the fields surrounding Angola aligned with rows and rows of white crosses, marking the graves of the inmates who never escape its grounds, even in death. In the late months of 1997, a lawyer arrived at Angola. Tom Mull had driven up from New Orleans in his soft-top checker car, trundling 100 miles along a winding 2-lane road through Louisiana's swampy bayou. It was becoming less sweaty in America's South, but the air was thick and muggy. Louisiana's Route 66 was a far cry from the famous artery that connects Chicago to Los Angeles. This Route 66 had big cracks running through it, like veins. It carved through an American backwater known for its alligators, crawfish, and slow pace of life. As a public defender, Tom had represented a number of Angola's inmates accused of violent crimes and was accustomed to visiting them in prison. He wasn't scared of those who had committed murders, nor of the brutality of life behind its walls. He believed that made him an unusual person. These prisoners were some of the most interesting people Tom had ever met. He was intrigued by the lifestyle and culture they'd developed within Angola's 18,000 acres. Then, as now, Angola was known for its annual rodeo. Every year, thousands of people travel down that narrow road with tickets to the prison's arena, where they're presented with an incongruous spectacle. Inmates cling to raging bulls, hoping that even if they don't win the competition, they will at least earn some time in the prison's hospital wing and away from their cells. There's an array of entertainment. Prisoners wrestle a bulldog out of a chute in one event, and try to mount wild horses as they charge around the arena in another. As a light reprieve, monkeys, wearing sparkly waistcoats, ride sheepdogs in front of the hooting crowd. The rodeo isn't the only tourist attraction at Angola. It also has a museum that documents its lethal history. The travelling electric chair from the 1940s. Descriptions of a great flood that washed disease and fear into the prison walls. And the story of the group of inmates who slashed their Achilles tendons in protest against forced labour. It was a slice of this culture that Tom was there to investigate. On this particular day in 1997, he wasn't thinking about his criminal clients. He had a new mission. He had been tipped off about a secret industry inside the prison walls. The greatest horrors tend to linger in the imagination, spawning further myths. That's perhaps why Louisiana State Penitentiary has so many nicknames. To some, it is still Angola. Others call it the farm, because inmates are forced to work the land. Every morning, they rise at a scheduled time and leave their cells for work. One group of prisoners harvests the fields. Another waters the prison view golf course and looks after the animals. Some have been known to make their own coffins in the prison workshop. It is also called the Alcatraz of the South, after riots and assaults became so commonplace in the 1950s that its reputation grew as notorious as that of the island fortress in San Francisco Bay. But there is another description of Louisiana State Penitentiary, one that Tom suspected could be its most fitting: America's bloodiest prison. Tom knew what to expect as he approached. There were the white barriers that suddenly cut the road short, and the sign warning visitors they could have their body cavity searched if they went further. He had heard the rumours of wolf-dog hybrids patrolling the grounds and seen the armed guards on horseback, but that wouldn't deter him. He passed smoothly through the layers of security. As guards checked his identity and rifled through his possessions, he thought about his time in the US Air Force and the checkpoints he would go through to enter the Pentagon. He pushed down the memories, trying to block the trauma from surfacing. Tom liked to think of himself as a modern-day Don Quixote on a chivalrous quest to help people. Alongside him, his wife Lorraine, with her analytical brain, and their band of small-town lawyer colleagues. Their lives were an organised chaos, travelling back and forth between Louisiana, where their law practice was based, and Hawaii, where they later moved. They needed the mental break afforded by their second home. After all, they'd spent the best part of the 1990s investigating the needless deaths of thousands of American children, an investigation that had now brought him to Angola. The first family to approach the moles came from outside Baton Rouge, the state capital that lies between New Orleans and Angola. Karen and Gary Cross were terrified for their son, Darren Bradley, known as Brad, who was 15 at the time and had a terminal illness. Since that first meeting, more and more families had approached them until they had hundreds of clients. The guards were Tom's first port of call. He knew some of them from his many visits to the prison, so he approached with confidence. He wasn't fazed by the guns that hung from their torsos. He didn't feel the need for protection. When the inmates discovered the truth, he was sure they would want to help him. A guard took Tom to a private room. He said he knew a hunter had recently come across a trove of evidence buried in the land outside Angola, needles and medical equipment that Tom believed were proof of the secret industry in the prison. He had spoken to a former inmate and the editor of the prison newspaper, the Angolite, both of whom were scared to testify because of the repercussions they could face. The guards were initially reticent too. If they gave Tom information on the record, they could lose their jobs. Tom conceded that they could talk privately to begin with. He just needed to get more information. With that, they started to open up. What the guards were about to tell Tom would prove his theory about how his young clients had come to be infected. Diseases that were rife within the prison walls had started to seep out, not only across America, but around the world. They were hiding in sanitary medical vials that pharmaceutical companies were building.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.